TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Luis Scott-Vargas. Top 8 lists of the week. This is getting pretty exciting for us, I think.
Yeah, I mean, we are called Channel Fireball after all, and so doing the top 8 red cards only makes sense.
Segway. That's why he gets paid the big bucks, ladies and gentlemen.
A Segway? I want a Segway.
Man, someone photoshopped me that one. You want a Segway? It's pretty good. We'll start right with the honorable mentions then for the top 8. Because cards that didn't quite make it, we wanted to talk about.
One of the few banned red cards.
Wait. Oh, yes. Oh, Curt Ape. See, I was going to start with Fireball because we wanted to talk about it. But Curt Ape.
Okay, yeah. Fireball. You turn a Fireball.
There you go. There, bam. Good magic card. But why they didn't play Disintegrate? I don't know. Whatever. To get on.
Curt Ape. Yeah, this card was originally banned when the Extended was first created, along with Juggernaut and Hypnotic Spectre.
Creatures were just too good.
They were too good. I mean, all of these cards then were reprinted in Standard and saw zero play. Well, Curt Ape saw play.
That's why it's on the honorable mention list.
Exactly,
there are plenty of like zoo-esque decks in Standard.
It won the Pro Tour, you know, when Mark Herbert played them. So
yeah, there you go. Honorable mention Curt Ape. Honorable mention Fireball. Still on our honorable mentions list, I'm going to point out Wildfire.
Yeah, this card has seen a fair amount of Pro Tour play. It's a powerful card. It doesn't feel very red. It's not very aggro. It's actually like very controlling.
Yeah.
But
usually complemented by control colors. Remember the old blue-red days.
Yeah.
Flametongue Kavu also.
Yeah, this defined a format. I mean, it wouldn't be insane right now, but it'd probably be good. I mean, we have Skin Render, but Flametongue, I think, is a lot better.
No, I mean, you get Magic players right now, it's like, does your creature pass the Lightning Bolt test?
Well, or the Jace test, actually, is the best one.
Sure.
Like Hero of Bladehold, for example, doesn't pass the Jace test and wouldn't pass the Flametongue test. Oh. But back then, you couldn't play creatures that cost 4 or more mana, or even like 3 mana. Well, 3 mana is okay, but 4 more mana that died to Flametongue was unplayable, unless it was a Flametongue. In which case, it was, you know, you Flametongue, they're Flametongue, they do it back, you do it back. This actually happened.
Exciting times. Yeah. Lastly, one more on our honorable mentions list was Burning Wish.
Yeah, I wish you could have made it on, but there's a lot of cards that...
Pretty sweet stuff, as Luis would say, that make it on this week's list. So Burning Wish, again, one of those like not so red cards. It usually went and tutored for Mind's Desires or
Or various vintage cards or
Buried Alives and Standard at one point, stuff like that. Excellent cards.
So let's get to the list.
Number 8. It's a pretty big deal here. We're talking about Fire Ice, I believe.
Yeah, Fire Ice is awesome. For basically 2 mana, you have a very versatile card because it taps their permanence. It cycles. You can pitch it to Force of Will, so it's never dead.
Yeah,
it's huge. It's a 2 for counterbalance, like. All those things are pretty useful. Like, it also, I guess, has a damage mode, but that's not really too important.
No, I mean, again, the fact that this card is never dead, as it's effectively another card.
Yeah, and icing their land on their upkeep on turn 2 when you're on the play is pretty insane.
That's a pretty big advantage for red or blue decks.
You put it on Icecrown Scepter, and you just keep using ice over and over again. And eventually, when you want to kill them, you use ice some more, and then draw something to kill them with. But
it's usually, like, Stroke of Genius.
It also pitches to Misdirection, too, just in case you need... You know, additional things. So
very versatile.
I think one of the best red cards they've ever printed. In fact, one of my favorite.
Definitely. Probably the one you've cast, maybe the second most out of this entire list, but yeah. Very high up there. Number 7, one that you're trying to cast more recently, Goblin Guide, still in Standard.
Yeah, it didn't work out so well for me, but Goblin Guide is, any like burn deck starts with 4 Goblin Guides automatically. It's, at the very worst, a shock. And then they have to deal with it. Or like them doing like it does like 6 to 8 damage on a regular basis. And for 1 mana you cannot ask for more than that. The fact that they draw extra cards every now and then, meh. You're not the kind of deck that can beat cards
you
anyway.
You still only play 1 land a turn for 9
And when you hit Goblin Guide turn 1 on the play, they just have to discard if they get a land. I mean, so yeah.
This guy's huge.
Goblin Guide is definitely a beating.
Number 6, we've got the REB, Pyroblast, Red Elemental Blast combo.
It's Red Elemental Blast because the beta versions are just completely destroy Pyroblast.
It is a sweet artwork, by the way.
Yeah. Pyroblast is a little better in some situations. You can cast, because it says if it is red or if it is blue.
If it is blue, yeah.
So you can cast it on anything, and it'll only happen if it's blue. So you can, if you want to get it out of your hand or
up
cast
your storm
it on
count,
Tar Pit Warrior or some like other targeted guy, you can just throw it out there. That being said, it's red's, you know, best version of Counterspell and stops cards that are better than any card red has, so that, you know, it makes it.
Again, a slightly reoccurring theme here, cards that act as though they were blue cards, pretty big on this list.
Yeah, that is true.
countering blue spells. Number 5, again, very similar to Time Twister.
Wheel of Fortune.
We have a draw 7, again.
Which you use to enable cards that aren't red.
Right.
Like Dark Ritual and Tendrils of Agony.
I'm sure there were times back in the day that you needed it to get your channel and your Fireball.
Or you Wheel of Fortune into like some Lightning Bolts.
Yeah,
or something.
Some Lightning Bolts.
Yeah, I mean, it's a restricted card. It's a powerful card. You certainly, you know, it's a dangerous card. Like, it's generally cast off, you know, the 1 red land in the deck. in a deck full of non-red cards, but that does not make it a bad red card.
I think it's kind of the unsung ability, the hero side of it to me. So I was playing in a cube match just the other day. My opponent goes like one drop, two drop.
Wheel of Fortune.
Two drop, wheels me. I'm holding like Moat, Gideon Jira. Oh, I'm sorry. The two drop he played was Tarmogoyf.
Oh.
I'm sorry. So that.
Nice. Yeah, so that's pretty sweet.
When he wheeled, you know, a couple of lands, Moat, et cetera, et cetera.
I also have to mention that one of the coolest Magic cards I've ever seen was a like mint beta Wheel of Fortune signed by Pat Sajak.
That is a good one.
It was impressive.
That is a good one. I know the person owns that, I think.
Yeah.
Number four, we're back on the Goblin theme right here.
Yeah, I mean, this is practically the top eight Goblin list. There are some Goblins on here.
It's funny when we sat down to talk about it. But Recruiter gets them all. Goblin Recruiter.
Yeah, I mean, he was also banned in Extended and also Legacy because of his interactions with Goblin Ringleader, with Goblin Charbelcher, the two Goblin cards.
I think it really speaks to the power level of the card, that it can go two-drop creatures, or it can just create this instant kill you combo.
You just Ringleader, so you have all Goblins on top, and you Charbelcher them for 20. Recruiter. Or you Recruiter, and then so you hit it, so you're having a Ringleader every four guys, so you just go War Chief, Ringleader, Food Chain. So
eventually you kiki-jiki some siege gangs and cast whatever. It doesn't matter, like they're dead.
Yeah, Goblin Recruiter, not a very fair card. It is funny, I have seen games where my opponents recruited for like 20 goblins, and then you counter their war chief and like, you know, destroy one of their like wasteland, one of their lands, and then all of a sudden that they're stuck with 20 goblins they can't cast. Like kill their vial, like it's so good. That's what they get.
Turn 11, you're like, I wonder if you're drawing. Well, not a land? All right, I think we're...
When you go ahead and like, you know, out of nowhere, Engineered Explosives, their vial, Wasteland, their Rashad and Port, then I'm stuck on two land drawing a pile of War Chiefs and Ringleaders.
Still the fourth best red card.
Yeah, moving on.
Number three, Fire Blast. Not really a good intro to that one. It's just...
Yeah, this has ended a lot of games pretty abruptly. I mean, sacking two mountains is a pretty big cost, but it doesn't matter if they're dead. I've lost plenty of games, even recently, to on Legacy, because it's still good in Legacy, and this is the card that put red really on the map in terms of, you know, burn decks. Like, this is one of the cards that led to the most turn four kills, where you turn one Jackal Pup, turn two Burn Spell, you know, turn three Ball Lightning, turn four Double Fire Blast. So.
And you even had four mana to cast things if you wanted to. It's a pretty big deal. Yeah, I mean, it's all right there. This card is great. Yeah. It's free four damage is really where we're getting at. Number two here, Goblin Lackey.
Yeah, the number one and number two slots are pretty well debated. Goblin Lackey might be one of the most powerful cards on the list, despite when it first came out, its best job was dumping Goblin Mutant into play.
Yeah, that's why, you know, when it was printed, it wasn't a big deal.
But it's one of those cards like Stoneforge Mystic that just gets better. And right now, turn one Goblin Lackey is one of the tests of Legacy. If your deck can't deal with that or outrace it, you're probably in trouble because they're going to be dropping, you know, Matron into Ringleader into Siege Gang into, you know, War Chief into Pile Driver and kill you on turn three or four pretty reliably if they get to hit you with Lackey. So
it's pretty obvious right there.
It's definitely power.
One of the scariest cards to, like, you're like, all right, vial that guy, or just cast it, and you're like, okay, my whole game changes.
But for the number one slot, we had to go with the classic. It seems
like we've already said it like a dozen times.
The iconic red card, Lightning Bolt.
Yeah, obviously.
I mean, it's one mana for three damage. It's insanely playable. Also, probably too powerful, but still, you know, ends up... Everyone loves this card. It doesn't feel that... It never feels too broken. It always just feels very good. And it kills Jace, kills, you know, Goblin Guide, goes with Goblin Guide. It just does everything. And, I mean, I cannot put down the Beta Bolts. I've used them so many times.
It's pretty much as long as there are decks that play creatures, you know, like in Magic, and that's kind of consistent, this card will be good.
I mean, we splash for it in our five-color control deck at Worlds and Extended. We've played as our cheap removal, and we had access to all five colors with Lightning Bolt, because Lightning Bolt's that good. I mean, it just does so many things.
And, you know, there are plenty of times where it's just like, get you. You're done. Yeah, so. Especially in my 4CC
If
deck
there was a card that could describe red, it would be Lightning Bolt. Much like blue has Ancestral Recall, red is Lightning Bolt. Yeah, part of the same cycle.
Yeah. Well, when I think white, I think healing. So yeah.
No, that's a good card to describe white too, actually. So that's our top eight red cards.
And, you know, seemingly like a theme that we might promote if we have the time and energy for it, but we've got a bonus list.
We can't promise it, but if we can knock them out quickly, we've got a bonus list this time.
Top 8 dragons.
I mean, we're on the topic of red. Dragons came up.
Yeah. Ironically, you know.
Most of them not red.
No. Some of them are red.
Let's get into it.
Starting at number 8, again, this list is a little wonky, and it's writing. I've got Yosei at number 8 here.
Yosei the Morning Star?
Yes, he is.
I've forced a lot of people not to untap with Yosei with, you know, various green white decks.
Was it 05 or 06 was the Greater Good decks?
That was Worlds 05.
05, okay.
Yeah. And where Mori won with Greater Good, and, you know, or no, he was playing against Karsten, who had Greater Good. Mori also had Yosai in his green white deck.
Okay.
But yes, there's Greater Good. Yosai was the combo. It would time walk them, you'd draw five cards, find another Yosai, repeat the process, they would die. So Yosai, pretty sweet.
I was thinking, like, you know, you could do it the old-fashioned way, you just cast a second one, and then you...
Yeah, I've done that, too.
let's keep on that theme of those
Champions Block
Champions
cycle.
Dragons. We've got Kaiga, the
Tide Star. Yeah, these were, like, one of the first really aggressively costed guys that triggered when they died, which means you always got, you know, good value out of them. Normally, you'd play a 6-drop, they'd kill it, end of story. Now, you play a Kaiga, the aggro deck sitting there with two creatures, it's like, what do I do now? I mean, Faith's Fetters was the best answer, but... Past that, you were pretty screwed. Like, you'd have to use a removal spell, then they'd take a guy and could block your other guy. Yeah.
Kaiga, you definitely played, yeah. would not you say? Let's move on to...
He was definitely a star.
Wuldgarger Dragon.
Not an actual dragon in the sense that you never attacked with it, but Animate Dad, Wuldgarger Dragon, infinite loop, because it removed the animate, put the dragon back, your permanence, you know, came back, the animate would come back, bring the dragon in, you tap our lands for mana, you get infinite mana, infinite bazaar activations, then kill them somehow. So
yeah, it was pretty much this is the first version, you still just turned your library upside down in your graveyard, then you targeted like Laquatus
or something like that.
Mana source.
Una, I guess, is a better choice now, but same thing.
Alright, there you go. Wuldgarger Dragon. More of a combo piece than a dragon.
Yeah.
But still a dragon nonetheless. We'll go the exact opposite route though. We'll go to Bogarden Hellkite here.
This is also a combo piece, you know, used with Dragonstorm. But past that, I mean, we cast this in block in the GPSF, which was held a block away from here, as we've complained about many times. And we're in downtown San Jose, just so you know.
But more importantly, you put this guy into your...
Because you can Mystical Teachings for it.
There you go.
And it was just, I mean, it's the best game ending, one of the best game ending guys in the format. Like, you play it, killed their entire board, or did five to them, and then just serve them up with a Bogarden Hellkite. So...
It's flash. It's flying.
Though the vast majority of his play was in Dragonstorm, so not so much an actual dragon, again.
Well, yeah, all right, fine. Covetous Dragon.
This is an old school one. This is one of the oldest cards on the list. Saw play in the Wildfire deck Kai used to win something with.
I think it was Worlds.
Yeah. One of the things Kai won. There's so many. Yeah, so use Warren Power Stone, Grim Monolith.
Fire Diamond, Thrawn Dynamo.
All these artifacts to turbo out Covetous Dragon into Wildfire, which worked pretty well together. Didn't kill the Covetous Dragon, didn't kill any artifacts.
It's as though this card was printed around those cards, but it only requires one black mana with four colorless. You're already getting a 6-5.
One red mana, but
sorry,
yes.
Yeah. One red, four colorless for 6-5 for five. Which, already...
Today would be laughably bad, but back then was quite sweet. So.
And lived through Wildfire, which is a big deal.
This is definitely a sweet dragon flavor-wise. It needs to have an artifact covet, and you know, did well play-wise too. So.
Okay, and we got Kakusho to kind of.
Kakusho's been banned too, you know.
In Commander.
Kakusho certainly led to a lot of deaths too. The double Kakusho was always the dreaded, you know, play Kakusho, attack for five, play second Kakusho, they're dead. So. These new dragons benefited really well off the new legend rule too, which is awesome.
Huge life swings. You can come back from being behind with this guy. I think it started with like the gifts decks in block really used it as kind of
a stabilizer finisher. Yeah, because you had Agoria's Vengeance, two of them or whatnot, and or just cast them, and you know they were pretty good.
Okay. Let's see. Number two on the list, Dragonstorm.
Yeah, I mean that fetches out. Well, Bogarden Hellkite on this list, but you could also fetch out Kakushos if you really were so inclined. I guess. You would now fetch out Karthus as well to give all your guys haste. Dragonstorm, you know, it won Worlds. It did pretty well for those people.
It's a combo piece. It gets all your favorite dragons. I mean, it's still kind of a casual card.
It tilts Paula when you mention it, because at that Worlds, Mihara started comboing, messed up, realized he was a mana short, repealed Paula's Savannah lines into the third Rite of Flame, killed him.
Wow.
Good story.
That is a good story. It seems like we're just blowing right through this list, but the number one dragon, which was felt pretty unanimously in the room when we came down with this, has got to be Bruce Lee.
Yeah, I mean, while we're putting things on lists that aren't cards, Bruce Lee definitely is the best dragon. I mean, you've got to enter the dragon, right?
Exactly. I mean, there's not really an argument to be made here. I mean, I would do no justice if I was even to start
and
talking
I would say if you put them hand to hand, he would beat all the other dragons on the list very easily. You just, you know, that's all you have to do.
All right. Well, there you have it. Top eight dragons. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Bruce Lee. Anything else before we sign off here?
Nope, that's the top eight or two of the week. Next week, we'll wrap up with, you know.
Luis's favorite color.
Yep.
Blue. Again. But no. Hopefully
no. We'll talk about green, and no fake blue cards either, because green's not good enough to have them. Thanks for watching.
Cut.
Was it Skargnoth? Skargnoth?
Yeah, Waffle got banned. Waffle got that. I don't know. But he got banned for leaking the spoiler.